We'll continue to cover it throughout this bulletin and our others as well. But let's now shift our focus to women in politics. And as I mentioned earlier, today, over 4,000 women leaders will converge at the Bomas of Kenya to declare their political stand in this year's polls. The women, including former presidential candidate Martha Karua and former Lands Cabinet Secretary Charity Ngilu, are expected to encourage other women to contest elective seats during the August 2017 elections. Public Service, Youth and Gender Affairs Cabinet Secretary Cicily Kariuki will open the convention. Others expected to attend are MPs Cicily Mbarire and Gladys Wanga of Homa Bay, among others. The Executive Director of the Center for Rights, Education and Awareness, Wangeshi Washira. Women want to provide visionary leadership and solutions to drive change. So that's exactly what we're going to be discussing right now with Janet Owuko, who is an analyst. She's with us in studio and an aspirant as well. Janet, thank you so much for joining us in studio.
You're welcome, Janet.
It's obviously a big event. It's bringing together 4,000 women leaders. And women constitute half of the voting population, but what are the factors that continue to disenfranchise opportunities for women either to vote or to stand for a seat?
Thank you, Janet. And I think traditionally women have been marginalized, you know, from the political setup. And this is because there are so many other things involved, you know, in politics. There's a lot of resources that are required. And of course, coming from a historical background where women were not really empowered so much more economically, it does not give them a footing that can make them compete with men favorably. Mm-hmm. And that is where affirmative action now comes in. And because we are saying that in affirmative action, we have got three grounds from where we are coming from in terms of saying we need the realization of the affirmative action so that we can achieve more women in leadership. And one of the things we are saying is that there is need for affirmative action because Kenya, you know, globally, that is the step and that is where all other countries are moving to, and Kenya does not want to be left behind. And two, there is a legal justification from where we are coming from. Our constitution clearly provides, you know, for affirmative action so that at least we can achieve the two-thirds gender rule. And, yeah. And third, mm-hmm. it is the value, because there is a lot of value that women can add, mm-hmm. you know, in terms of the development milestones that this country wants to achieve. Mm-hmm. So in terms of having more women in leadership, mm-hmm. then it is argued that development of this country can actually be fastened by having more women in development.
All right. Yeah. Let's take a look at the 2013 elections, for example, Janet. And it's clear that there was no woman governor, for example.
Right.
Was it a case of lack of interest, or do you think there were deeper issues around some of the issues women face when running for certain seats?
And I think you can still trickle it down to the issue of senator and still go go down to the member of parliament positions where you can see the number of seats that women managed to garner had it not been for the women representatives positions. Mm-hmm. And I think the statistics, and even going back down to the MCA positions, mm-hmm. so I think the statistics are very clear that unless something is done, women may not be able to favorably compete, you know, with men on the political arena. There are so many things, Janet, that come to play, and especially, you know, thinking even about the security. For example, as an aspirant, I would tell you that sometimes you go deep in the slums, and as a woman, you really feel so much vulnerable, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I really want to believe that there is a lot that this country can do mm-hmm. in terms of encouraging more women, you know, to compete in politics. And part of that, we are saying, mm-hmm. we almost go into the nominations, you know, party mm-hmm. nominations. Mm-hmm. And it is upon the political parties to show goodwill and to show goodwill to women who are looking at political parties and saying, we are looking at you and seeing how much more are you interested in putting women in leadership positions. Because mm-hmm. even at the nomination stage, mm-hmm. you know, the competition is just the same. Mm-hmm. It is not favorable for many women. Talking about, for example, maybe the fees that are required for you to be able to register, right. and, you know, and all these other requirements. And I think we are saying, can we have political parties that really commit themselves in terms of saying, within our nominations, we will achieve the two-thirds gender rule. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because at the end of the day, those that will be nominated are the ones that will probably now be able to compete in the, you know, in the elections.
Okay.
So it begins at the primaries and saying, at the nominations, what exactly do we want to see? Mm-hmm. What affirmative action issues are the various political parties mm-hmm. putting in place to ensure that it is friendly for many women? Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, we have more women, you know, representatives in parliament and in every other elective position.
All right. As we wind up, Janet, there's also a place for women in society to support women who are trying to vie. Is that an issue that also needs to be addressed? For example, I think there's various countries, if I can highlight, for instance, the U.S., whether or not it goes on, but where a body of women come together and even try and fundraise for women who they feel can contest in elections and that kind of thing. Do we also need to reach a place where we reach out to women across the board and say, listen, this is for the betterment of you and I, because you get the sense that women don't support women who are running or who are vying for seats. I stand to be corrected, but that's really the impression that comes across. So how can we rally women to stand behind women who want to go for these positions and make sure that they send them to the top?
I think a lot of this, I am an aspirant myself, and I would tell you my biggest supporters are women.
Okay.
So I really, the narrative that women do not support women, I usually see it being advanced against, as a weapon against women. But I would tell you that the convention of today, it is dubbed pamoja hadi kwa debe, because we are saying as women we are going to support each other, all the way to the vote. Because as you say rightly, women, yes, form a majority of this country, and we know that even when you have a woman member of parliament, they are more approachable, and so the benefits that we are likely to get when we have women in leadership is more.
Yeah.
So what you're trying to say is that at the end of today, a strategy is going to be unveiled as to how women are going to work together so that we can achieve the numbers when it comes to the vote. But I think we also need to get a little bit higher. It's not just about supporting me with your vote. What else is required? A lot of resources are required.
Exactly.
And yes, we have women business, who are doing well in business. These are some of the strategies that are going to be explored by today's event, in terms of saying, can we work woman for woman, and can we raise more women that can be able to support other women in terms of women resources, in terms of strategies? You have women who are strategists and so on and so forth, because even if you do an analysis, women are doing so well. Like, for example, in business, we have women who are doing really well in strategies, in big offices. So it's not like we have a shortage of women that are needed in each and every
and yet Janet, some of them may feel a little scared to mix their business with politics. What would you want to say to them? Because like you're rightfully saying, the business community, women are growing there. They may have a feeling of wanting to support, but they're scared of getting intertwined with what is termed as dirty politics in Kenya. Yeah. What do you want to comment on that?
I think a lot of capacity building is needed, even for women folks, across board, not necessarily even the woman who is right there at the, at the grassroots. Because if you look at politics, even at the presidency and so on and so forth, you really see a very big role of business tycoons playing even the positions of governors and so on and so forth. But I think this whole idea of women being shy, and politics being associated with all this dirt and so on, we are moving a step further in talking to women and telling them that politics is about who gets what, when, and how. And so when we have good women that can be able to make good policies for this country, your business benefits.
Right.
So even as a business person, you have a lot of stakes in terms of even protecting your business when you support good quality candidates to become leaders of your country.
Okay. Well, we're hoping that the convention is going to yield the results that you're hoping for. I think it's a fantastic opportunity for women to come together and encourage each other in politics, and wishing you all the best as well.
Thank you so much for taking
time to talk to us today, Janet.
Thank you, Janet.
Right. So of course, we're going to take a short break, and we're going to be coming back with details of the GSU passing out parade a little later on that President Uhuru Kenyatta is expected to be presiding over. Stay with us, Extra. We'll be back right now.